Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch. Welcome to Beam of Grace Ministries. Thank you for tuning into this channel. My name is Apostle Wisdom, and in this segment, we are going to continue with our series, Understanding the New Testament. And today we're dealing with part 5 of the same series. The title of part 5 is The Mystery of Law and Grace. One of the most controversial and misinterpreted concepts out there is the mystery of law and grace. So we are going to discuss and demystify this principle, law versus grace. Turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse 17 to 18. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophet. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. These are the words of Jesus Christ himself. And in this portion of scripture, he is revealing something, though it is hidden in verse 17, in verse number 18, he is revealing it. Let's read part B of verse number 17. I've not come to destroy, but to fulfill. Now, part C of verse number 18 says, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. So Jesus is saying, I came to fulfill the law, that the law can pass. Why am I saying so? Verse 18, part C says, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till be fulfilled. But from verse number 17, part B, he's saying, I came to fulfill the law. So Jesus automatically, the moment he fulfilled the law passed. This is the mystery. Everything we're going to discuss is based on these two verses. Because in verse number 18, he appears to be saying the law will continue forever and ever. But he said in verse number 18, till it is fulfilled, then it will pass. Now in verse number 17, he said, I am come to fulfill it. So Jesus is the end of the law. Why? Because he came to fulfill it. And once the law is fulfilled, it passes. So Jesus Christ is the end of the law. So I'm here to explain some few concepts. Why did the law and the prophets come? If Jesus was to come and fulfill it, so that it passes, why did the law and the prophets come? In the first place, why did it come? Turn with me to the book of Romans, chapter number 3, verse 20 to 21. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. So the first reason the law and the prophets came were to witness, were to forerun Jesus Christ, were to educate people about the coming of Jesus Christ. People were not going to be able to identify Jesus Christ when he comes in the flesh. People are going to be able to see and to know him and identify him. So the law had to come. The prophets had to come and educate people and be witness and lead the people unto Christ. So the law is not bad, but the law just came to be witnesses, to be indicators, to point people unto Christ. People weren't going to be able to know about Christ if prophet Isaiah had not prophesied, unto us a son has been born, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son. All those things were done so that people will be pointed to Christ. People were not going to identify Christ if prophets were not come, if the law was not come. Let me give you another evidence that the prophets and the law only came to point people to Christ, to be witnesses of Christ. John chapter number 1, verse 45. Philip findeth Nathanael and said unto him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Wow. Of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus. So the whole law, all the Ten Commandments, the 600, more than 600 statutes and commandments, they were just pointing people to Christ. Not that they will remain forever and ever. Once Christ comes in and fulfills the law, in which his life, his death, his resurrection should match the description of the law, should match the description of the prophets. Hence it is fulfilled. The moment Mary conceived as a virgin and begot a son, the prophecy was fulfilled. The moment he ran to Egypt, the prophecies were being fulfilled. So he was fulfilling the prophecies so that people could trace and know that this is Jesus of whom Moses in the law and all the prophets spoke about. Let me give you another evidence. Luke chapter 24, from verses 44 to 46. I just want to make you understand that the law did not come to continue forever and ever, but the law came so that it can be a witness of Christ, so that it can point people to Christ. Let me read Luke 24, 44 to 46. And he said unto them, these are the words I speak unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled. Remember, Jesus came to fulfill, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses, and in prophets, and in Psalms concerning me. So the prophets, the Psalms, the law of Moses was just introduced to educate people, to point people to Christ. Once what's written of him in the law, in the prophets, in the Psalms, is fulfilled, then the law passes, so that we are no longer under the law. Why? Because he fulfilled it. Let me give you another scripture to just further explain why the law came. John chapter number 19, verse 28 to 30. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were fulfilled, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, I thirst. Not that he was thirsty, but he wanted to fulfill the scripture. Because somewhere, I'm going to show you that scripture, it was prophesied. Verse 29. Now there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar and put it upon hyssop and put it to his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. It is fulfilled. What was written of me has been fulfilled. What has been written of me in this life has been fulfilled. So when people are seeing these things happening, they will know that truly, truly, I am the Christ. And he bowed his head and gave up his ghost. After finishing the fulfillment of the scriptures, after fulfilling the law and the Psalms, he said, it is finished, and he gave up his ghost. Now, I want to show you that he was not thirsty, but he wanted to fulfill the law, the scripture, the Psalms, and the prophets. Let's go to Psalms, when David was prophesying about this incident, about him being thirsty. Psalm 69, verse 21. They gave me also gall for my meat, and in my thirst They gave me vinegar to drink. So when Jesus said, I'm thirsty on the cross, he wanted to fulfill this prophecy in the Psalms of David, that they gave me vinegar to drink. So the law, the prophets, and the Psalms, all those things are just speaking about Jesus Christ. The moment he fulfilled it on the cross, the office of the law passed. So that we are no longer under the Old Testament order, law. We are now under grace. Now someone will be asking, how are you saying it is finished? It means you fulfilled it. Let's go to Colossians chapter number 2, 16 to 17. Let no man therefore judge you in meat, in drink, in respect of a holiday, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. There are aspects of the law which are very important to some people in some denominations, which have been clearly specified here. But let no man judge you in meat. Some are still complaining, yeah, you eat this, you eat pork. The Bible says that was the law which was fulfilled. Some say worship on a Saturday. Some say worship on Saturday. That was fulfilled on the cross because Jesus became the Sabbath. The moment he fulfilled it, he got actually him as the place of rest. So we entered into him as is our Sabbath. So that's why he said, let no man judge you of the Sabbath. Sabbath days. Why? Because he fulfilled it on the cross and it passed. This thing was just a shadow. The law was a shadow. The prophets were a shadow. The Psalms was a shadow of Christ. The body belongs to Christ. He fulfilled everything on the cross. Let me give you the last scripture to show you that the law only came to be a witness, to let people identify Christ. Galatians chapter 3:24-25. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under the schoolmaster. This one is too powerful. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster. It only came to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under the schoolmaster. Which is the schoolmaster? The law. So we are no longer under the law. We are now under grace. We are now under grace. Someone is saying, how come you're saying grace? Where is grace coming from? Let's go to John chapter number 1, verse 17. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. So when Jesus came, he came with grace and truth, such that we are no longer under the schoolmaster, which is the law, but now we are under grace. You see, people, they don't understand these things. Some, they believe the law passed and they split it into two. This law passed, this one did not pass. That's why we hear them, they speak in tongues and they say, we received this by grace, we were saved by grace. But after preaching, they'll say, now come and pay tithes that God can bless you. That's confusion in the body of Christ. Those are heresies coming from the devil. Why? Because the law was just a school type. It was just a schoolmaster to help us submit unto Christ. The moment he came with grace and truth, we are in him. The Sabbath, obeying it, it was a schoolmaster that will rest in Christ Jesus. It was a shadow of people being saved and resting in the bosom of Jesus Christ. It's no longer I who lives, but Christ lives in me. Once I enter in Christ, I've entered into the Sabbath. So the law passed when Christ came. The law, the schoolmaster came with Moses, but grace and truth came with Jesus Christ. So we don't need to pay tithes to be justified and any blessings. We need to believe and enter the Sabbath, which is the rest, which is Jesus Christ, that we are justified and we are blessed. So you see, people are mixing two things. One which was done away with. They are mixing it with the current and existing thing. The law was fulfilled. And the law was crucified on the cross. And it led us unto Christ. We thank the law for being the schoolmaster that it led us unto Christ. But now that Christ has come in his volume, we are no longer under the law. We submit to him and him alone. Jesus fulfilled the law, such that we enter into his rest. We enter into him as our supper. We are no longer required to observe the law that we can be justified. We are no longer required to observe the law that we can be blessed. By virtue of us being born again, being saved, and being in him, we are blessed. I want to give you sufficient evidence that Jesus fulfilled the law on the cross. Jesus is the end of the law. Romans chapter number 10, verse number 1. Brethren, this is Apostle Paul writing. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel. Remember, Israel was the one who was given the law. Now, Paul is saying, brethren, my desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. They were observing the law, but they were not saved. They were observing the Sabbath. But the Paul is saying they are not saved even though they are observing the law. They were paying tithes. But Apostle Paul is saying, I pray that with all those tithes they can be saved. For I bear them record that they have zeal of God, but not according to the knowledge. You know, they have got zeal of God. They pay tithes. They keep Sabbaths. They don't dress anyhow. They don't do fine anyhow. They follow the commandments and the statutes given to them by God through Moses. Then he says, they have zeal of God, but not according to the knowledge. They don't have this knowledge that Christ is the end of the law. Verse number 3, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves under the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. Let me read verse number 4 again. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. Christ fulfilled the law. You know, he said, I did not come to destroy but to fulfill. But once it is fulfilled, every iota, every tittle shall pass. So he fulfilled it and he became the end of the law. So we are no longer required to worship God on Sabbath. We worship God every day because John chapter number 4, it says, God seeketh true worshippers. We shall worship neither in that mountain or in that place, but we shall be worshippers in spirit and in truth, not in such a day. That's why Colossians said, let no one judge you on Sabbath days. We worship God any day. We worship God. That's why we do teachings. Monday to Friday, we do teachings. We reach the world with teachings because we don't serve under the law. We serve under grace, for Christ came with grace and truth. Verse number 4 again. For Christ is the end of the law. For righteousness to everyone that believes. For Christ is the end of keeping the Sabbath. For Christ is the end of tithing. For Christ is the end of putting on garments with one type of linen. For Christ is the end of circumcision. For Christ is the end of all the 600 statutes. Let me give you another evidence. Ephesians 2, 13 to 16. Christ is the end of the law. But now, in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Jesus. He was writing to Gentiles, people like me, I'm a Gentile. Because I'm not the seed of Israel. I'm a Jew. So he's saying, you were Gentiles. You are sometimes far off. Now I'm made near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, whom hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us. You know that the Lord did not allow the Jews to worship in the same place with Gentiles. So there was a middle wall of partition there, which did not allow people to meet, even intermarriages were not allowed. So he broke that law, the set of commandments, which did not allow us to receive grace, having abolished in his place the enmity, even the law of commandments. What did he abolish? The law of commandments contained in ordinances. Some are saying the laws were not, the Ten Commandments were not abolished. Here is the scripture. Having abolished in his place the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances. These were the ones written on the tablets. For to make himself twain one new man, so making peace, and that might reconcile both to God in one body by the cross, having slain enmity thereby. Jesus abolished the law. It's surprising to see Gentile pastors, after preaching that they received the Holy Spirit, they are saved, they will start saying, now pay tithes. They will begin to ignore that tithes is a component of the law. Yes, tithes are component of the law. So you see, people, they're saying, we're saved, yet they preach the law. They're saying, we're not under the law, that's why they worship on Sundays. They say we're not under the law, but they still preach the law. Why do you keep on preaching tithes when you know that you are no longer under the law? Christ abolished the law. I'm going to give you in part 6 of this series the mystery of John's head, and I'm going to reveal the mystery behind some components of the law being preached in churches which are preaching grace. So don't miss this one, the mystery of John's head. You will see why up to date some ministers, even Gentile ministers, they preach tithes which are part of the law. I met a brother who said tithes are not part of the law. They came way before the law. I just want to answer this question to the world. Now, Hebrews chapter number 7, verse number 5. Hebrews chapter number 7, verse number 5. Hebrews chapter number 7. And those descendants of Levi who received the priestly office have a commandment in the law to take tithes from it, that is, from their brothers, though these are also descended from Abraham. Let's read this phrase again. And those descendants of Levi who receive the priestly office have a commandment in the law to take tithes. So you see, people, they preach grace, prayer, we can eat pork, we are no longer under the law. We worship on Sunday, we are no longer under the law. But when it comes to tithe, they say, tithe is not part of the law. The mystery of John's dead. Don't miss part 5 of the New Testament series. Okay, let me move on and give you another scripture which shows that we are no longer under the law. Colossians 2. 13 to 17. Let me start from this thing. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of the flesh, have he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Verse 14. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. Don't forget that the Ten Commandments, which you so esteem, the Sabbath, which you so esteemed, was part of the handwriting inscribed on the stone tablet. Now the Bible is saying, verse 14, blotting out the handwriting of God that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. He took the law out of the way and nailed to the cross. So when people were busy crucifying Jesus on the cross, Jesus was busy crucifying the law, that us Gentiles can be acceptable. This is sweet. We were not supposed to worship. We were dead in our sins and in the uncircumcision of our flesh, because we were not given the law. The law was given to Israel. But for us to be incorporated into the body of Christ, He blotted out the handwriting of the ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and He took it out of the way by nailing it on the cross. So when they were nailing Jesus on the cross, Jesus was busy nailing the law. That's how He fulfilled the law. We are no longer under the law, brethren. We are no longer under the law. We are no longer under the Old Testament order. That's why He concludes saying, verse 16, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of any holiday, of the human or of the Sabbath days. Let no man judge you on the Sabbath day. Let no man judge you on tithes. Let no man judge you on the way you pass. Let no man judge you according to the Old Testament. Now, there's a question which is very valid, which I have to answer here. So, are we now lawless? As being in the New Testament order, are we lawless? In other words, are believers lawless? Yes, Apostle Wisdom, you are saying one of the Old Testament order. So, can we just kill? Can we just commit adultery? Are we lawless now? Let me answer this very important question. I'll start from Romans chapter 3, verse 27 to 28. Let me make this clear. We are not lawless, but we are not under the Old Testament law, in which law is governing us as believers in Christ Jesus. Romans 3, 27 to 28. Where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Let me read again. This is the Apostle Paul. Where is boasting then? It's a question. Then he answered this. It is excluded. Then he asked another question. By what law? Of works. So he answered two questions. By what law? Number one. Number two. Of works. Then he answered these questions. Nay, by the law of faith. Wow. So we are not lawless, but when Jesus abolished the law, when Jesus had fulfilled the law, the Old Testament law, He established a new law which is called the law of faith. That's why John chapter number 1 verse 17 says, for the law was given by Moses, this is the Old Testament law, but grace and the truth came by Christ. So He didn't just abolish the Old Testament law, He didn't just abolish the Mosaic law, but He established the law of faith. Verse number 28 of Romans 3. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. A man is not justified by paying tithes. A man is not justified by observing the Sabbath day. A man is not justified by putting on white color garments. A man is justified by faith. Verse 29. Is he God of the Jews only? Is he not also of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also. The moment Gentiles were qualified into the body of Christ, the Old Testament order was replaced with the New Testament order, which is governed by the law of faith. Let me show you that the law of the Old Testament was done away with, and the law of faith was introduced. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 16-17. But if the ministration of death, written and engraved in stones, do you know that there are a lot of people up to now, they say the Ten Commandments were not done away with. They do agree that the law was done away with, but they say the Ten Commandments cannot be done away with because it's God's finger who wrote it on the tablets. That's the only evidence they have. It's God's finger who wrote it on the tablets. Second Corinthians. But if the ministration of death was written in the garment, the same Ten Commandments you so esteem, it is being referred by Apostle Paul as the ministration of the day. The Sabbath is the ministration of the day. The Sabbath is so esteem, it is the ministration of day. But that's, it was the fourth commandment engraved on the stone tablets. Was glorious so that the children of Israel would not steadfastly behold at Moses' face for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away with. How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation, the Ten Commandments written on the tablets, here Apostle Paul saying the ministration of condemnation be glory, how much more does the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory? For even that which was made glorious, now this is now Moses being referred to that, for even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect by reason of the glory that excelled. For if that which is done away was glorious, how much more that which remains? The law was done away. Now, something which is remaining. Jesus. Let me read to you verse 15. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, don't forget that Moses is not just the law, it's not just the Ten Commandments. Genesis. It's so that to Deuteronomy, it's Moses. But even under this day, when Moses is read, when you read our text, the veil is upon your heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. When you preach the Sabbath, you still have the veil. You can't see the true gospel. When you preach tithing in your church, when you preach tithes, tithe that God can bless you, tithe that you avoid devourers, you still have the veil. When you are saved, when you turn and repent, that veil shall be taken. I urge you, brethren, that you turn and repent, that the veil of the Lord is taken away from you. Now, I still want to emphasize on the fact that a new law was established. We are not lawless. Hebrews 7:11-12. If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, get this. If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it people received the law, was further need. What further need was there that another priest should arise after the order of Melchizedek? If the law could bring perfection, what further need was there that another priest should arise after the order of Melchizedek and not to be called after the order of Aaron? So we've already two orders. The order of Aaron, which is the Old Testament order, and the order of Melchizedek, which is the order of Jesus Christ, which is the New Testament order. For the priest would be then changed. I love verse 12. Read verse 12. Hebrews 7, verse 10. For the priest would be changed, there is made of necessity a change of the law. So Jesus did not leave believers lawless. He abolished the Old Testament order, the Old Testament law, but he established a New Testament law. Verse number 12, for the priesthood being changed, there is made a necessity, there is made of necessity a change of the law. So there was a change of the law. The Old Testament order being done away with, the New Testament order, the law of faith being established. Now we want to see the components of the laws of faith. What does Jesus say about the, did he really establish a new law? Did he really establish a new law? John chapter 13, 34, 35. Yes, Jesus abolished the law. But did he really establish the new law? Which we are calling the law of faith, the law of grace. John 13, 34 to 35. A new commandment, these are the words of Jesus Christ himself, establishing the new law. After abolishing or being about to abolish the old law. These were just days before his crucifixion. So he was sitting on the New Testament order, the law of faith. The new command, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. As I've loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So he's now setting up a new commandment. He's very specific. Having abolished or being about to go to the cross and abolish and fulfill all scriptures about him, he established a new commandment. And he said, his own words, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples. People shall not know God's disciples by tithing. People shall not know God's disciples by keeping the Sabbath. But people shall know God's disciples by love. So you don't steal because of the commandment. I don't steal because of the love I have for my neighbor. I cannot steal from my neighbor. I don't commit adultery because of the law. I don't commit adultery because of the love I have for my neighbor. If I love my sister, I cannot commit adultery with her. I don't do things because God said, do not. I do things because the love of God is in me and it moves me and doing things. I have faith that Christ lives in me. It's no longer I who lives, but Christ lives in me. When Christ is living in me, I'll begin to live the love, the life of love. I'll begin to love my neighbor. I cannot fight around because I love my neighbors. I cannot steal from my neighbors because I love my neighbors. I cannot do evil because I love my neighbor. So I'm pushed by love, not by a threatened case. I don't give because there's a threatened case, but I give because I have the love of the work of God to go. So I give more than 10%, I give 20, I give 30. If I don't have, I give 1%. If I don't have material things by then, I don't give any material thing. That's why Peter said, silver and gold we don't have, but such as we have, we're going to give you. We give out of love. We are moved by love to give because we give a new commandment to love. When Christ comes in us, we begin to love. That's the New Testament order. So we are not lawless with the commandment to love. 2 John chapter 1, 5 to 6. I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in truth. As we have received a commandment from the Father, and now I beseech thee, children, not as though I wrote a new commandment unto thee, but that which had from the beginning, that we love one another. And this is the love of God, that we walk in His commandment. This scripture, particularly verse 6, confuses a lot of people. And this is love, that we walk after His commandments. So people say, oh, if we're walking after the commandments, so we're walking after the Old Testament order. No! Where then is the boasting? It has been excluded. By which law? The law also explains, but by the law of faith. So the commandments we're dealing with are the New Testament order commandments, which is the law of faith. Love one another, love yourself, love your neighbor, love God. So once you obey these commandments, then you love God. That's why he's saying, and I, verse number 5, and I beseech thee, children, not as I wrote a new commandment, but that which we heard from the beginning, that we love one another. He specified the commandment. The one which we heard from the beginning is that we love one another. If you love God, then obey this one. He didn't say obey this one. He didn't say obey that. He said obey, love one another. The last thing I'll give you as evidence that Jesus established a new law. Galatians 5:13-14. For brethren, we have been caught unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by the love save one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love your neighbor as thyself. All the commandments, Jesus said, I give you this one, I've replaced the old. That's what Apostle Paul is saying here. For all the law is fulfilled in one. He fulfilled all the law in saying, love one another. So when one is saved, he becomes part of the New Testament church, the church of the festival. Whether Jew or Gentile, once born again, you cease to be a Jew or a Gentile. You become the New Testament church, the church of the festival. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter number 12, 22-23. But he are come unto Mount Zion, and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and unto an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly of the church of the festival, which are written in heaven, and to God the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of the sprinkling that speaketh of better things than the blood of Abel. When one is born again, you become part of the New Testament church. And the New Testament church is not governed by the Old Testament law. It is governed by the law of faith. Love one another. Love your neighbor. Love God. John chapter number 10, verse 16. And another sheep I have which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall be one fold and one shepherd. This was going to the Jews, but they thought Jesus belongs to them, God belongs to them. So he said, you think I belong to you? I'm going to establish a New Testament church. And there are some sheep which are not of this fold. I'm going to bring them. There is Apostle Wisdom there. He is not a Jew, but I want to incorporate him in my church, the church of the new, the firstborn. I want to call upon those whom I've written and call them unto Mount Zion, and they shall obey my commandment. They shall obey my voice. What is my voice? Love one another. That's the law of faith. Love your neighbor. Love God. How do you show that you love God? You love your neighbor. So Jesus said, I'm going to make one fold, which is not under this Mosaic law, which is not under your law, which is not under the 600 commandments, but which is under my voice. And my voice is this, a new commandment I'm giving you now. Love one another. Let me conclude by going to Galatians chapter number 3, 10 to 14. Then I skip, 24 to 25. You can read the whole chapter 3 of Galatians. It's quite nourishing in the spirit. For as many as are under the works of the Lord are under a curse. It doesn't matter you're in the New Testament church. If you find yourself preaching the law, preaching the components of the Old Testament law, teaching people to pay tithes, teaching people to observe the Sabbath, you are under a curse. For as many as are under the works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all the things written in the book of the law to do them. Once you teach the Sabbath, observe the word, the commandments of clothing, the commandments of agriculture, the commandments of strangers, the commandments of sacrifices, circumcisions, you should observe. But once you observe one, observe all. Don't be a minister who mixes grace and the Old Testament law. You are putting the people of God under the law. You are teaching a wrong doctrine. The law of Christ, which is the law of faith, love one another, is distinct, is separate, cannot be mixed with the law of Moses. You hear people after speaking in tongues and say, we receive them by faith. They will begin to say, now if one God to bless you, pay tithes. You are putting people under a curse because the Bible, Galatians 3:10, for as many as are under the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continues. You are saying, you worship on a Saturday, for one no longer under the law. That's fine, that's true. But why are you saying now pay tithes in the same Sunday service? You put congregants under the law, so under the case. Verse number 11. But that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident. For the just shall live by faith. We are no longer living under the Old Testament law, we are living under the law of faith, which blotted away the Old Testament law. Verse number 12. And the law is not of faith. These two are different. The law is not of faith. The law is not of faith. The law is not of faith. But the man that doeth them shall live in them. Christ had redeemed us from the curse of the law. Christ redeemed us from the curse because no one could observe the law. No one could pay tithes. No one could keep the Sabbath. No one could dress according to the law. No one could farm according to the prescription of the law. So Jesus removed the law for us. They made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that is hanged on a tree. He was hanged on a tree so that he becomes the curse and we become the blessed of God. We don't need to pay tithes and bless. Jesus took our position of a curse that we are blessed. That the blessing of Abraham might come to Gentiles through Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. We don't receive blessings promised through Abraham through tithe. We don't receive them through keeping the Sabbath. We don't receive them through dressing with one type of linen. We don't receive them through circumcision. We receive them through Jesus Christ by faith. Verse 24 and 25. Therefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under the school. Brethren, the law, the prophet, and the son only came to educate us about Christ, to point people to Christ, to be the schoolmaster, to bring us to the faith. Now that Christ became a curse on Calvary, he took away the law. He blotted the handwriting in the commandments, inscribed on the stone tablets, and he removed them, making a way for us Gentiles and the believing Jews to form one fold with one shepherd, Jesus Christ, and one law, the law of faith. Love one another, love God, love your neighbor. Thank you for watching.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.